Hi there, my name is Nicole Hebert with the Moosejaw Journey to Hope team, and this is Voices of Recovery.
So if you have maybe like one thing that you would say that stands out the most to you as also being both a caregiver and a family member to somebody who is recovering in a way that like we have to respect to like your sister as well, but if you have something that stands out to you in being both a family member but maybe a caregiver of someone that is going through recovery, what would be like a message that you feel is important for other people to hear?
I don't know, with my sister, it was hard. I used to, I'll just talk a little bit about it. I used to run everywhere for her, right? Because I'm like, hey, I'm in recovery, I'll save you, right? Mm-hmm. Sometimes people just, they're not there yet. They don't want to be saved. Mm-hmm. And sometimes my love, I loved her so much and I wanted to help her. And I did all these things that, you know, I lost love for myself because I was loving her so hard, and it turns out I'm loving her to death, right? And that's a hard thing to accept. That it was a little over a year ago that she relapsed. So I was started to have the behavior patterns of an addict again. Like when I was in active addiction, I was staying up for days because I'm taking care of her kids. Meanwhile, she's in psychosis, trying to keep her happy and calm, and then taking her to the hospital and staying up all night. And then she'd get the needle and she'd come back out and she'd be okay for a day. So I try to go home and sleep, but she's, you know, going through the withdrawal. So now I got to stay there and watch the kid. And like, it was just like this ugly pattern that just would not go away. And it was, you know, going on for months. And eventually I could recognize that I was going to use. I was either going to use or I was gonna hurt someone, you know, like by accident, like not by accident, but because I had let this stuff bottle up. Mm-hmm. And I realized that I was loving her to death and enabling, right? Yeah. And the hardest thing in my life to ever do was to, you know, accept somebody. My sister uses a drug where she relapses weekly, like almost 2-3 times a week, is Narcan, naloxone back. And so I had to accept the fact that, you know, my sister is going to die from this disease, right? She is going to die. And when I can't save her. I can't save her. So now I'm there for her when she's ready to come. And you know, she has those days where she calls me and I'm like, okay, let's get you onto the detox list. Like, but the ball's in her court, right? And I can't score the basket for her. I can only just pass her the ball and let her play the game herself. I don't know if that makes sense. Like it's a bad metaphor, right? But because like, and I love her, and you know, sometimes me being her sister, I'm not the greatest person to be giving advice. It needs to be someone else because I'm so emotionally involved. Mm-hmm. I'm still learning. Like I'm still learning how to do it. Don't be afraid to ask for help. I was like, oh, I'm Mrs. Recovery, you know, like. Everybody knows me as this person who starts meetings, who, you know, who's always out there doing all these things. And it was hard for me to admit, I don't know what to do when it comes to my sister. And it was the first, and like, here's another thing. Most people that come to me for help want help. Mm-hmm. My sister didn't want help, right? And that was hard. That was really hard. No matter how much I pushed, you know, she didn't want the help. And so now I'm here and I'm waiting. You know, I have accepted, I don't think you can ever really accept it, but I can't save her from dying. If she's going to die, then that's going to be what happens, right? Mm-hmm. But I can be here for when she's ready. And I pray every day that she, you know, she chooses to come to this side of the fence because it is better. I am, once we heal from the trauma, from the reason we started using, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.